Glad you're in the house of the Lord today. May God bless you, keep you. Praise God. Praise God. Let me just mention that on Wednesday night is our back to school service. And every year we give things to kids in school equipment and supplies. If you would like to be participate in that, we just have today to do it. You can come this evening. There's a basket, I believe, out in the hallway for you to deposit any supplies in. But please keep that in mind. Today at 1 o'clock, a Spanish service. And tonight at 6 o'clock, we're going to have an old-time Pentecost around here. And we hope that you'll come and be a part of that. This coming week, Wednesday night,
is back-to-school rally. And I wanted to tell all of you that are shoppers, Myers has a great sale. So I was over there and I bought a bunch of things to donate.
Oh, really?
Yeah, a plug for Myers if they're watching. But we do need your donations because the kids depend on us helping them with school supplies. And we also not only fill their backpacks, we fill their tummies. And I was thinking, you know, a lot of times you think, well, I can't be here on Wednesday. I can't cook. I can't this. I don't drive a van. But if you just want to donate a jar of ketchup and mustard, you could do that and stock the pantry. Help in any way you can, because you would not believe all the people that we come in contact with that are saying, oh, by the way, you're the church that's feeding all those kids, right? Larry was working. We worked Larry like a dog Wednesday night. I mean, we had him and Brother Domingo and Sister Mary and Marlene. We have a lot of helpers, but you know what? Many hands make light work. And we're not only feeding their stomachs, but we're feeding their hearts and their minds, and we're planting seed. The Bible says that when we throw that seed out, some's going to land on stony ground. We're not going to win every last one of those kids, but somewhere in their lifetime, they're going to remember, oh, I remember that United Pentecostal Church. And so we're planting more seeds than you can even imagine for the glory of God. I'm serious about this, and I believe that what we do is going to matter for eternity. You may not see it right this moment, but I'm just telling you, I want to just give this little personal testimony. When you're praying, God's working this week, and I can't give you the whole testimony yet. Someday I will, but I want to tell you that God answered a prayer for Pastor and I this week that was phenomenal. And you know what that scripture you quoted about him giving us back out of men's bosom, you know, and he's going to bless us and all that. I can't quote it right. But I'm just telling you what, something happened and a prayer was answered for us and they thought it was their idea. Really. And she said, can you let us do this for you? Please don't make us do this. I'm like, duh. You know, we were praying for a situation and God intervened and she thought it was her idea. And I told her, and you'll know more about it later, I said, when we're done with this, I'm throwing the biggest party ever. She said, the only caveat is you got to invite us to that party. I said, you're invited right now. God will give you the desires of your heart. If you're praying, God's working. So when we're planting seeds on Wednesday night, somewhere in these kids' lives, they're going to come against, what do I do? What do I do? Ugh. I was talked to in youth class, and Jesus is the answer. So if you donate a bottle of ketchup, peanut butter, we can always use that. So anyway, I'm wholeheartedly sold out about Wednesday, Pastor.
That was one line.
I know it.
Wednesday night.
What else would you like me to talk about?
Well, if you're preaching, we'd get out of here about 3 o'clock this afternoon.
I'm sorry, but I'm anointed. I had to share that good news.
You know, it's cool. I was in a bank this week doing banking for another church.
Same line. He's going on the same line.
And I was sitting at the desk with the banker and a lady at the teller. She had gone up to the teller, turned around and looked at me, and she goes, you're Pastor Lehman. She goes, you're from that Pentecostal church down there on the Dixie Highway that feeds all those kids on Wednesday night.
Yeah.
She goes, I just want to thank you for what you're doing. She says, we will come to your assistance. We will have. I said, how do you know me? She goes, I know Anita.
Need we say more?
Good things are happening on Wednesday night. This coming weekend's Labor Day weekend, and I know there's a lot already gone. I know some are going to be leaving, having a great Labor Day weekend because the snow's fixing to fly. And
Shh. We want Netherly's friends to stay. Stop. Stop. It's not going to snow for a long time. No.
But Labor Day weekend's coming up, but this Sunday is a fifth Sunday. It's Labor Day weekend. It's also Unity Service. There's one service Sunday. We hope that you'll be a part of that. Be here in the presence of the Lord. Good things happen. And on Monday, a week from tomorrow, at the campground is Pure Michigan Praise. The Wilbanks are going to be there. and several other groups are going to be a part of that. If you would like to go down, I think there's a $10 donation to get in that gives you lunch,
barbecue,
and some good things happening if you want to take the trip down to the camp. To those men that went this weekend, I know Brother Murdoch went, and who else? Brother Walter and his son went, and Jim Garza's boy, is he here? No.
Santiago.
Santiago went, and I'm telling you, what an incredible men's retreat. And with the help of the Lord, I will give you Morning Manna is coming up in a couple weeks on Saturday morning. If you'll come to that, we're going to have breakfast here at the church, and then we're going to have devotion. We hope that you'll come. It's the first Saturday of the month, 8 o'clock, and we'll give a CD to those messages that were preached. What an incredible time we had in the presence of the Lord. One other thing, on September 3rd is a blood drive here at the church, and our young people, our youth department, receive $10 for everyone that comes through the line. You may not be a giver from what I understand, but as long as you come and attempt to give, they're going to give our youth department $10. So we will be dragging you in by the hairs of your chinny chin chin to give blood, and just a good time to give. Isn't God good?
Yes, amen.
God is good. Come on, would you sing one more song with us today as we look, before we look into the word of the Lord today? For the reading of the word of the Lord from Acts chapter 19. Glad you're in the house today. Thank you for coming. Acts chapter 19. I would like to think that maybe I'm one of those individuals. I know you're not. start something, you always finish it. But I hope there's several things I want to talk from these verses of Scripture. This just even this one verse of Scripture, it's not very long, has really not much to say, except it does have a powerful question at it, but maybe for a few weeks. But Acts chapter 19, verse 15, and the evil spirit answered and said, the spirit's now talking, coming through an individual, Jesus I know, and Paul I know, but look at that question, but who are ye? I think hell wants to ask that same question to us today. Paul I know, Jesus I know, but who are you? Who are you? And I'm not asking that question in an evil way, I'm asking it in a positive way. Just who are you? Who are you in Christ? Lord, we love you today and we thank you for your word. I just pray that you'll help me today to deliver my heart. I need you today, God. In the name of Jesus, I pray that you'll speak to our hearts. Lord, you know the enemy and what it wants to do to all of us in this house. Lord, help us to know who we are in you. Help us to know that we have strength and ability in you that is beyond our comprehension. We have the ability to take advantage of it through your Spirit in the name of Jesus. Help us, speak to us. If you don't help us, God, nothing of any value will happen, but you can do a great work through your word. In the name of Jesus, we pray. And everyone said, amen. 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 You may be seated in the name of the Lord. When you read in the book of Acts, man, what an incredible, incredible book. I say it before, but I'll say it again. If you want to know what the foundation of the church is, you don't go to Old Testament necessarily. You don't go to the Gospels. You don't go to the Epistles. You go to the book of Acts. Because the book of Acts is the Acts of the Apostles. You want to know how to be saved, you go to the book of Acts. You want to know how to be baptized, how to receive the Holy Ghost, you go to the book of Acts. You want to know how a church is supposed to operate, you go to the book of Acts. Correction of the church is made in the epistles. But when you read the book of Acts, God is doing an incredible work. Highlighted in the book of Acts is this man named the Apostle Paul. And what an incredible man of God that he was. For you find in Acts chapter 19 and verse 12 that the Bible says that God wrought special miracles by the hands of Paul. The sick were healed. The dead were raised. Simply by his shadow passing by and touching men and women, they were healed. It wasn't the shadows that brought the healing. It was the power of Almighty God that was upon an individual, and God brought great works. Not only did that happen, but evil spirits were cast out, not by the name of Paul, but by the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I propose to you that this church needs to strive for that same kind of mentality. That it's not by our might and it's not by our power, but it's by the Spirit of the living God that does a transformation in the hearts and lives of men and women. And the church says, amen. It's not our ability that's going to save. It's not our ability that's going to bring the move of God. But when my people, the Bible says, which are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray, God said, I'm going to hear from heaven. I'm going to open my eyes. I'm going to open my ears. And I'm going to do a great work. The problem was in the book of Acts 19, there was those that looked upon what Paul was doing and thought, well, looky here. They saw what he was doing and the power that he had. And they decided that if Paul can do it, we can do it. The foolish mistake of people to think is that sometimes we can have a move of God without having any anointing upon our life. Or that we can have God by coming together and just singing. I'm sorry, but I have been to churches that sing songs that we sing. I'll never forget in California once Sandy and I went to a church because there were some things about it I wanted to see how they did. And I walked in as they were singing a song written by Mark Condon. And I listened to them sing that song. And I'm not trying to be judgmental. I'm not trying to be negative. But man, it just wasn't happening in that place. You know what I'm talking about. It's happened in here too. We can sing songs and we're just singing songs. But when we have the anointing of God that's resting in the house, when the Lord is in the house, you can't just sing a song. That's why people say, I don't know what's about this place, but I feel something when I come in here. I begin to cry when I come in. It's nothing that we've done. It's not by our might, but it's not by our power, but is by the Spirit of the living God in whom we believe in. These boys said, well, looky here, we're going to do the same thing. So they tried to cast out a devil from a man. And when they came against the man, they said, we come to you in the name of Jesus by whom Paul preached. Well, that didn't work too well. Because the Bible says that evil spirit that controlled those men leaped upon those men that were using the things of God in a defrauding way. They didn't have the right to use the name of Jesus. They didn't have the right to call upon that name. Now, anyone could call upon that name, but only those that had the power that is vested in them through the name of Jesus, they're the only ones that should be able to have or do have the ability to cast out devils in the name of Jesus. So when they defrauded that name and they took upon themselves something that they rightly didn't have, the Bible says those evil spirits jumped upon them men and they said, we know Jesus and we know Paul, but we have no idea who you are. And within moments, they beat the fire out of those men. They beat them so bad that they were stripped of their clothes and they ran away naked, bleeding, and wishing to God they had never done what they've done. Now that's Lehman's translation of it. Read it in Acts chapter 19. That's basically right there. You see, hell knows who you are. I'll just say that again. Hell knows who you are. Or maybe I should say, hell knows of whom you are. Hell knows if the Spirit of the living God dwells and lives within your life. The question is, if hell knows and heaven knows, do you know of whom you are? Is it you or is it Christ that liveth and dwelleth in you? I pray to God that somehow there would be an understanding of who you and I are in Jesus Christ. Because I'm telling you today, if the church ever gets an understanding of who we are and of whose we are, we would understand that in the name of Jesus, we have power, we have authority, we have dominion. It's not in us, but it is a God that dwells and lives inside of us. So I propose to you today, when you read Acts chapter 19, the Apostle Paul comes walking into their world. They didn't know who he was. They may have heard of who he had been and who he was now, but he was an unknown. They had never met him in Acts chapter 19, but they were fixing to meet a man of God that was full of the power and the anointing of Almighty God. They had no idea that he once was an agent of hell. that hell had dominion over the Apostle Paul. They had no idea, maybe, or maybe they did. Maybe through time they had heard of whom he was, that he was once called Saul, but he had some incredible encounter with this one named Jesus of Nazareth on the way to Jerusalem, to Damascus. Even though Jesus had already ascended into heaven, this Apostle Paul had an encounter with Jesus Christ. I've come to tell you today, he may have ascended into heaven over 2,000 years ago, but you and I still have the privilege and the honor of meeting him and knowing him and having him dwell and live on the inside of us today. You need to know as a child of God that there is a greater power that lives within you than that lives within this world. You need to understand that when you walk out of the doors of this church today, when Christ lives in you, Christ goes with you. When you walk into your school this next couple of weeks, young people, I've come to tell you, you don't walk in by yourself, but you walk in under the anointing and the power that's in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. He may have once been employed by hell, but now he was employed by heaven. You may have a past that you're not proud of, but you can have a future in God that is powerful, that is mighty, that is great, that you're not just yourself any longer, but you are an ambassador of heaven. When Paul came walking into town, he came in as a preacher of the gospel of hope. When he came walking into town, he came walking in a preacher of grace and the power and the majesty of Almighty God. He may have walked into town when his name was Saul, as a killer, as a destroyer, of one that would rip families apart. But there had been a transformation in his life. The church, the body of Christ, must never, never, never come to a place that you underestimate the power of God. You must never come to a place that you forget where you were as well. You must never never forget that one time I was employed by hell. But now God, who was rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved me, found me in my sinful state, and he picked me up. He picked me up out of the mire of sin. He washed my sins away. He filled me with his Spirit. Now I am a child of the utmost high God. We must never forget where God brought us from. I'm sorry, if you're saved, you're just not a sinner, but you're a sinner saved by grace. Sin no longer has dominion over you. You have the ability to rise above sin. You have the ability to live godly in an ungodly world. Now notice in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 8, nay, Paul writes, you do wrong and defraud, and that of your brethren. You defraud. Now, he's not talking to a bunch of sinners. He's talking to the church. He's talking to those that have experienced the book of Acts. It's a church in Corinth. And he's saying, hey, there's something wrong here. You've defrauded even your own brethren. And he tells us, he gives us a little understanding, actually, that you're really not telling the truth of whom you really are. For in verse 9, know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Be not deceived, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, or adulterers, or effeminate, nor abusers of themselves with mankind, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God. He just gives us a little list there of who is not going to make it to heaven. Now, he's just told them, you defraud. You're playing a game here. You're not being trustworthy here. You're not being truthful here. Notice what he says in verse 11. And such were some of you. You know what can sort of turn my stomach? When I hear people judging younger people for their actions and condemning them to hell when I've been around long enough to know what they were when they were younger. And you know why? Because I was there too. I remember what it's like. And it's easy for us 52-year-old people, individuals, can look down at some younger folks or some maybe newer folks into the family of God and think down, well, what little lowdowns are you? So the Apostle Paul just puts it on the line. Know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? And then he gives us this litany, this whole list of those that shall not. And he says, and just remember, just don't forget that such were, I'm glad he used the word were, such were some of you. But the reason you can say such was I is because you have been washed. You have been sanctified. But ye are just, and you have been justified, not in your name, but in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God. He's saying, listen here, you were a little loser one time too. You were one that was lost and down in the pit too. But thanks be to God, because he has washed you. Thanks be to God, because he has sanctified you. Thanks be to God that he has justified you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of the living God. Just in case you don't get it, what he's saying, he says, you've been changed. There's been a transformation in your life. When you repented, when you were water baptized, when you were filled with the baptism of the Holy Ghost, there was a transformation that brought about the change in your life. It's not because of who you are, but it's because of whom he is and of whom you serve. That is the reason that I need to give God praise. Paul also wrote in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 17, I pray there's no more moving in and out right now, because I'm coming after someone here today. I'm coming after an individual, and you'll find out who I'm coming after in just a moment. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 17, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away, and bingo, behold, all things become new. If any man be in Christ, he is that new creature. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. And how do you know if you're a new creature? Old things are passed away, and behold, all things become new. The Apostle Paul says, the things I used to hate, I now love, and the things I used to love, I now hate. Why? Because there's been a new creature showed up in this flesh right here. I'm a new creature. You're a new creature. Listen, if you're loving the old flesh, something's wrong. If you're loving the old flesh, you need to have a wake-up call. You need to go get back in Christ. Because when you get in Christ, you don't have a choice. There is a new creation. There is a new love. There is a new hate. Paul preached. He preached it hard. He preached it strong. When it came to sin, he didn't say you could walk that double line. He didn't say you could walk the old way and keep the new life. No, he said you got to get rid of that old man and walk in the new man. If your Holy Ghost didn't change your life, you don't have the Holy Ghost. Well, Pastor, that's pretty strong, isn't it? I'm just telling you what the Word of God's saying there. If there's no transformation in your life, something's wrong. And it's not the Holy Ghost. Something's wrong in my life. And so when I start loving the things I used to love, and I hate now the things I used to, I love the things I used to hate, and I hate the things I used to love, that I need to have a little checkup in my spirit. What's going on? Because there needs to be a newness in my life. I don't walk just like everyone at school. I don't talk just like everyone at school. I don't talk like everyone at work. I'm not like the neighbor next door. I'm not like the man on the job. Why? Because Christ lives and dwells within me. Now, in Paul's day, they didn't like as strong kind of preaching. In fact, I'm not going to get there today, but I started this week studying in regards to the grace of God, and that Paul's preaching of the grace of God, men didn't like it so much, so they flipped it on him. Paul was preaching about the grace of God. And the only reason you have the grace of God is because of your unrighteousness. Because you couldn't save yourself. And you couldn't live up to the Old Testament law. And because of your unrighteousness, God wrapped himself in flesh. And he came among us to save your hide and my hide. That's why he came. But those bunch of heathens that had walked in the newness of life, but somewhere had walked astray, flipped the grace of God and said that evidently the more we sin, the more grace is showing up. They had this idea that you could sin and it was okay because there was always grace to cover from your sin. But he went on to say, shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. He preached a message that if you fell, there was always grace. But you don't prostitute grace because you just want to live any kind of way you want to live. And that same spirit's in the world today, that you can prostitute grace and think God's going to say it's okay. And God's not going to say it's okay. But if you will repent with godly sorrow, grace will show up. Mercy will come to your rescue. But don't you prostitute grace for your own sinful pleasure. We are living in that kind of day. I'll come back to that some Sunday. But I'm just telling you, we're living in that kind of day when we don't want hard preaching and strong preaching about holiness and righteousness and living above sin. But I've come to tell you, as I told you last Sunday night, I'm sick and tired of people messing with grace. I'm sick and tired of people thinking that I can live any kind of way I want to live, and God's going to understand. No, he don't understand. Because grace came to you. And when grace came to you, it came to save you and to redeem you. Paul wrote to young Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 1, I charge you therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing in his kingdom. Preach the word. That's what I'm trying to do today. It may be not very good, but I'm trying to do that. But listen to me. He says, Timothy, preach the word. Be instant in season and out of season. It doesn't matter if you feel like it or not. You keep on preaching. And this is what you do. You reprove, you rebuke, you exhort. Now, them are pretty strong words right there. With all long suffering and doctrine. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but they will, after their own what? After their own lust. Do we have any of that in this world? Do we have any of that in us? Yeah, I think we do. But after their own lust, shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears? And notice what they will do. They shall turn away their ear from the truth and shall be turned unto... You got to be kidding me. You have once heard truth. You have once endured sound doctrine. But you don't like it because that lustful spirit... Now, don't come and tell me you don't have a lustful spirit, because we all have that. It's just a matter of keeping that under control. Don't think that you're ever going to grow up someday and not have lustful spirits and lustful desires. I've had an old man tell me, and I'm thinking, my God, at your age, you're still lusting like that. Yeah. So don't think for a moment that you're going to get so spiritual that you're not going to have to fight with lustful spirits. You're a fool to think that. The enemy has tricked you, because all you are is carnal flesh. But you don't have to succumb to that lustful flesh. You don't have to give way to that lustful flesh. Because when you do, you will start heaping to yourself teachers. Tell me something I want to hear. That preacher's too hard. He's preaching it too strong. I don't want to hear it. And I'm here to tell you that you will end up believing a fable. It amazes me when I hear people and what they now believe. That I knew they once had a strong faith in God. That they once had a deep walk with God. And now they have some weak kind of fable. That is, my God, you got to be kidding me. How did an intellectual individual like you come to this? Because they've allowed the flesh to so control them that they don't want that hard preaching. But just give me something I want to hear. Preacher, preach me something I want to feel good about. And God said, I'm going to turn them over to a reprobate mind. Ears that turn away from the truth. It is amazing what people believe today. That same Paul had to deal with those people that had taken the grace of God and they had defrauded it. They had seemingly destroyed it. They had made lies about it. Notice the warning that comes in Jude chapter 1 and verse 4. Jude chapter 1, verse 4. There we go. I need to take this one whole thing one time and talk about it, but they come in unaware. Have you ever had someone sneak in on you and you didn't know they were there? They snuck in the side door, they came through the window. They may have been your friend, they may have been your enemy, but you didn't know they were coming in. They came in unaware. They came in and all of a sudden they were there. That kind of, same kind of thing that's in our world today and just that has always been there, people that creep in unaware, is in the spiritual realm the same thing, that there can be spirits that creep into our lives and we didn't even know where they came from. They just show. Have you ever said, wow, where did that come from? Wow. What caused me to do that? Ungodly that turn the grace of God into lasciviousness. Now listen to me. Lasciviousness is lustful desires. And we're all grown up in here today. They're sexual things that all of a sudden just come up and we wonder, wow, where did that come from? They come in the side door. They have snuck in on us. And we would have never thought that we would allow them thoughts to penetrate into our hearts and our lives. But man, all of a sudden that they're there. And I'm here to tell you, you'll never outrun those spirits, those lustful thoughts. They're always going to be there. But as I said earlier, what you do with those lustful thoughts are going to determine where you go in life. He goes on to say, one translation says, even perverting the grace of God. The lawless immorality, and they call it grace. Listen, the grace of God that has appeared unto you and to me. No, let's turn with me, and I'm almost done here. Titus chapter 2, and this is where I'm coming home at. No more talking in this house. I'm getting bold here. I'm tired of the enemy messing with our church services. Notice what it says in Titus chapter 2 and verse 11. For the grace of God that bringeth what? It has appeared to all men. Notice verse 12. Teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. This is where I'm coming home on it. Listen, the grace of God that has appeared unto all men. The grace of God. We're living in a world that Christianity is telling you and I that, man, the grace of God's just abundant. You just go ahead and do whatever you want to do because the grace of God will cover it. But that's not what Paul writes in Titus chapter 2 and verse 11. For the grace of God has appeared to all men. And what does it do when it shows up? Oh, we're heading back to school season. Grace. It's just not some kind of little mushy, grushy, little good feeling. But when grace shows up, grace is the old teacher. And he's not that liberal kind of teacher that says, oh, just go ahead and chew your gum. Just so go ahead and bring your iPads and your cell phones, and you don't have to listen. In fact, you can put your head down in my class and you can sleep. That's not the kind of teacher grace is. Because when grace comes walking through the door, you better be sitting up in your seat. You better have a number 2 pencil in your hand. You never had to have that paper land out there that looks like wood still floating in it. You remember that to the old folks? Yes, young kids don't know what that is. We used to get paper that was sort of green. They went green long before you guys ever showed up. It was green that had lines about that wide. Had that little dotted line going down between. Remember what I'm talking about? Anyone in the house, remember that? And it had wood still floating in there. Little chunks of wood. I promise you, you'd be right. And I'll say, whoop, he hit that little piece of wood. Grace, when grace shows up, it's just not, well, show up if you want to. But when grace shows up, grace comes in to teach us something. Don't be sucked into this world. It's telling you grace is just something that's abundant out there and it'll just do whatever and it will cover up. No, when grace shows up, it says, I'm here to teach you something today, boys. Now listen, when a real teacher tells you they're here to teach you, you better take heed. I had teachers that, remember the old racers that were about that size? Had all the chalk on them. If you weren't paying attention, he would throw it at you. And he'd hit you upside the head. And it didn't matter if you told daddy or not, because you're going to get a whipping when you got home if you didn't get that stuff off your face. Now you can probably get the teacher kicked out of school for doing that, but not the true teacher. Teacher said, when you come to my class, you're going to listen up. They'd get you standing in the corner with 2 arms stuck out like this, and they'd put books on them. Remember them? Remember the teacher that had the ruler, walked up, pull your hand out. It's like, my God, I'm not going to hold my hand. Hold your hand out there, and whap. Anyone remember those days? Yeah, I'm not talking about I'm not beating up on teachers today, but I'm talking about a teacher that walked in the room that, buddy, sort of like the judge when the judge walks in. But But you know what? We're living in a society that even the judge don't have any respect anymore. I stood in a courtroom some time ago with an individual that needed to have mercy that day. That individual needed the mercy of the judge that day. And the judge said, well, what should I do with you? And the dude standing in chains, feet and changed arm, and that boy wasn't going anywhere. He said, the judge said, what should I do with you? He said, I don't care what you do with me. And I'm standing next to him. I thought, this is a foolish day for me. Why did I even come? Man, if I'd have been that boy, I'd have said, sir, I am asking for pity today. I'm asking for mercy today. I'm asking for grace today. And the judge picked up that old gavel and went, boom! And he said, I'm going to put you where the sun don't shine. I'm sorry. That's where he said, and you know what he did too? Why in the world would we stand in judgment with that kind of attitude? Because we're living in a world today that's telling us, don't tell me how to live. I'm going to live it my way. I'm going to do it my way. But I'm here to tell you, when grace shows up, it's just not there to make you feel good. Grace has showed up to tell you that you need to deny ungodliness. Grace has a message to tell you that you need to walk away from worldly lust. Grace will tell you today that you need to live soberly, that you need to live righteously, that you need to live godly in this present world, right here, right now. Grace. Don't tell me that grace is just there to make you feel good, that's there to cover you up. Grace is trying to teach us something today, but we want to run from the grace of God. We really, oh, we'll take all the lovey-dovey kind of grace, but grace comes up to teach us some things that we dare take heed to. For where sin abounds, you may say, well, man, Pastor, it's pretty bad out here. Yeah, that's true, but where sin abounds, grace shows up. And it doesn't just cover up the sin, but it's teaching us, listen, you're going to live a miserable life in your life when you don't submit to the grace of God. When you don't come to a place where you start denying the ungodliness, where you don't learn to walk away from lustful thoughts, and you don't learn to live a righteous life, don't call for grace, because grace will always bring about that. Grace goes on to say, looking for that blessed hope and that glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity. He has come to bring us out of all of that sinful state. He's come to purify you and to make you a peculiar people. You know what grace wants to do? Grace wants to so change you that people fold their arms and say, wow, I've never seen an individual like that. Wow, how can they live godly in an ungodly world? How can you walk away from the lust of the flesh that will so torment you? How in the world do you live soberly in a world that's in drunkenness? How in the world do you live righteous in an ungodly world? How in the world can you live like Christ? I'll tell you how it is, because grace has appeared. And grace is leading and guiding and develop my life into something. And in closing, let me just, I'm done, but in 2 Timothy chapter 3, say come. Listen, if you don't hear anything else, about 9 o'clock today, 8:30, man, something smote me. Because I really feel like Saginaw Valley is on the verge, in the midst of incredible things. God's doing incredible things. I'm not on the verge. He's doing incredible things. But don't think for a moment that hell's going to pull back, because hell's out to destroy your marriage, sir. Ma'am, God, the enemy is out to destroy everything about your godliness and righteousness. And if you don't take heed to grace that comes teaching you something, you're heading for trouble. Timothy, he says, know this in 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 1. In the last days, perilous times shall come. Just listen to this. See if this matches up with the day that we're living in. For men shall be lovers of their own selves. They'll be covetous and boastful and pride. They'll be blaspheming. They'll be disobedient to parents. They shall be unthankful and unholy, without natural affections. Shall be truth breakers and false accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good. Any of that going on? Traitors, high-minded, lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God, having a form of godliness, but they deny the power thereof. Timothy, from such, turn away. Because it's of these type, and he gives an example, that evil men shall creep into houses and shall lead captive silly women laden with sins. They lay in wait just to creep in, to come in. They lead them away with divers lust. Listen. Then he gives us this last picture of what the world is going to be and the church is going to be like. He's not writing to a bunch of sinners. He's writing to a bunch of church folks. They're ever learning. Could it be said that they're ever learning from the grace of God? Grace is showing them that's ungodliness, that's unrighteousness. Why don't you live righteous? Why don't you live godly? I know we're living in a wicked world, but right now you have the ability to do it through grace. Grace can teach you some things. But they're ever learning. You know what makes me sort of ill? Is there's more Pentecostal people that know how to live, but they choose not to live it. They know the things of God. Grace has taught them. They've been around grace so long that they can teach it backwards. They can do the alphabet spiritually backwards. They can sing the songs. They can quote you the scriptures. But the Apostle Paul says they're ever learning, but they're never coming to the knowledge of the truth. When that laid on my heart this morning, I thought, my God, that can be us. That can be us right there, that we're ever learning, but we're never coming to the understanding of the incredible grace of God. I've come to tell you today, I've come to tell this assembly, you better know who you are, and you better know of whom you are. You better know that Christ is living in me, that I have crucified the flesh, that I'm not walking in this ungodly world, and I'm walking in the same manner that they're walking. No, but there's been a transformation in my heart and my spirit. Why? Because grace is teaching me some things. Grace is pulling me. Grace is causing me to... Don't allow the flesh to tell you. Grace is just there to let you go ahead and do it. And just as those Jews said, listen, just go ahead and sin because the grace of God's so great. No, grace is not that. Grace is a teacher. Trying to teach you something here today. Lord Jesus, you know each of us by name. Lord, you know more about us than we know about ourselves. Hell even knows about us. But oh God, would you help us to know who we are today? I come against that lustful spirit that will defraud the grace of God, that will take grace and allow some lustful thing to come creeping into our life and lead us into captivity. Lord, I plead for your mercy today. I plead for your grace. Some of us are a long ways from where we should be. It's been a long time since we've had a fresh touch of your anointing. Lord, you've called us. You've called us for a reason. You've started us on this journey. God, don't let us allow lust to so control us, to send us contrary to the things of God. In the name of Jesus, come on, would you just begin to pray right where you're at? Yesterday I heard a thought that I thought was so incredible. Every day we need to be praying that God would not allow us to be tempted, not allow ourselves to become defrauded. When you're defrauded, when you're taken advantage of, you don't know that you're being taken advantage of. When somebody comes in and defrauds you, you have no idea. God, would you help us to have eyes to see deception when it walks through the side door? Lord, I pray that you would give us the ability to see spiritual things that the enemy's trying to destroy us with. But grace is in my life today, and grace is here to teach me some things. Oh God, would you do a work? Come on, would you just ask God for the mercies of God and the grace of God to appear?
Now, oh, I need your mercy.
leading the way. I don't think there's anything more hideous in life than somebody that's been deceived by hell. They're so deceived, but they don't know they've been deceived. And I firmly believe with all my heart we're fighting a spirit of deception that's in the world today like never before. Deceiving men and women, deceiving young people, deceiving us to think that it doesn't really matter. Oh my God, I come against that in the name of the Lord. Deception will destroy you when you don't even know it. People will plead for you, but I'm just fine just the way I am. And you've taken grace and you've defrauded it when grace is really there to lead you and to teach you and to guide you. I open this altar on this Sunday morning to individuals that just worry about being defrauded. Listen, you'll take all kinds of time and effort to secure your computer system and your bank account and your retirement against fraud. But when there's a spiritual fraud that's out playing with your spiritual life, playing with your marriages and playing with your kids and playing with you yourself, and you don't even see it, I'm here to tell you, you talk about something that should turn us upside down, because we can gain back material things, but we'll never regain a life that's lost without God. I'm just pleading with you today. Just come on, Saginaw Valley. We just need to be checking every step of our way. Is this grace, the grace that God wants to give that's going to lead me? Or if it's grace, it's saying it's just some sloppy kind of thing. You can just do whatever you want to do. But according to what it says, grace is going to teach us some things. And either you're going to get an A or you're going to get an F. Either you're going to know in whom you are, or hell's going to think, oh, there's no worry about that individual because they're not allowing grace to lead them and guide them and direct them. Come on, as we sing it again, I need a church full of individuals that are secure that grace is leading. You're not allowing grace, some sloppy grace, to lead you in a path that you're never learning, but you're ever coming to the knowledge of truth. God right now. I don't want deception in my life. I don't want to turn the grace of God into lasciviousness. I don't want to turn the mercies of God. In the name of Jesus, I rebuke it. In the name of Jesus, I come against a stronghold. I need your mercy, oh God. oh God, help us, I pray. You're looking at the work of grace right here.
That's right, amen.
You want to know what grace does? It does it right here in Brian's life. Someday he's going to tell you an unbelievable story. He's going to tell you about the incredible grace of God and how God brought him from a long ways. And I believe God has great things in store.
Amen. Amen.
He's going to tell you why he hasn't been baptized till before today. He's going to tell you why he's baptized today, someday. It's just nothing but the grace of God.
That's right. Amen.
You've received the Holy Ghost, huh? Now, if it wasn't freezing cold water, I'd get him out of here real quick, but it's like bath water today, so he can just sit there. Brian, I'm proud of what God's doing in your life, man. God has great things in store. You've already repented of your sins. You've already been filled with the baptism of the Holy Ghost. And today, we're going to just do the washing, what the blood of Jesus always intended to do, and I'm just asking you from this day forth, which you have, but continue to let grace teach you and lead you and guide you. If you want, you can hold your nose with that finger, this hand here. Just hold your nose with it. Brian, on the confession of your faith in the name of the Lord Jesus, your willingness to be baptized, I baptize you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins. He's already filled you with the Holy Ghost. In Jesus' name. That's it, man. They're gone. They're gone, Brian. They're gone. Never been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. There's only one name whereby we must be saved. It's the name of Jesus. If you've never received the gift of the Holy Ghost, you need the gift. That's that spirit that lives within you. You got to be filled with the Holy Ghost. And it's just that, then you need to walk a godly life. And grace is going to lead you. And grace is going to teach you.
Yes, it is.
If you find people that just seemingly walk away, you wonder, wow, how did they do that? Well, they just didn't do that. They weren't learning from grace, because grace is always trying to help us. He's that teacher trying to help you. Come on. Come on, Lehman, get it right. That's ungodliness. And when it speaks to you, when it gives you a big old fat F, man, take heed to it. Say, oh, God, help me in the name of the Lord, that when it comes again, I'm going to say, thank you, grace, that it brought it to my attention. That you know what? You can live godly in this present world. He wouldn't have put it in there if it wasn't true. You and I can live godly. We need godly men. We need godly women. We need godly young people. We need godly kids. And it's not us, but it's the grace of God that has appeared unto all men. Lord, we love you today. Thank you for your presence. Thank you for what you're doing in Brian's life. Thank you for what you're doing in our lives. Thank you for grace. Thank you for that teacher that's come to teach us and to lead us and guide us. Now will you direct us this day, this week, this month, this year? Help us allow grace to be the teacher of our life. Thank you for what you have done, but I thank you for what you're going to do. In the name of Jesus, we pray. In the church said, amen. God bless you. See you tonight.
To your love, by your power, your throne.